Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the launch of work that very industrious team at NCER has been doing for the last year and a half. We'll recognize the team members shortly when we release the report. This is work that has been triggered with the very generous and thoughtful support of the Umidia Network India. And I'm very pleased that Shilpa Kumar, partner for this kind of work, is with us, as is Shreya Deb, who's been our line straight to God, donors are gods. So Shreya
has been a straight line to God
on this. And of course, our team leaders are here, Deepak Sanan and Professor Gupta, who always never wants to be on stage, but he's, I hope, somewhere here. And there he is. Third row, third bencher, and Shomnath Sen, who also likes to have his work seen, but not himself. And Shomnath Sen is also sitting in the back, and we'll introduce the entire team. So this work has led us first into testing and on a pilot basis, looking at the Government of India's Digital Land Record Modernization Program,
work that was also
sponsored and supported by Umidia Network, and where we really formed this brotherhood or sisterhood of these institutions that came together, NIPFP, IGIDR, and NCER, when we did that first phase of work and got to know each other and each other's strengths. And I think that led us to think about, and led Umidia, most importantly, to think about forming a network. And so you, as you saw in our gallery, it's a very strong network, and I hope it will grow and prosper. Each of us is doing our own work, and there, I'm sure, will be parallel events like this that other institutions in the network will be doing. This work itself is about a land records and services index. The idea is very simple. When you rate people, people like to see their rating improve, and that leads to all kinds of incentives to improve, in this case, the digitalization of land records. It opens up a whole area of work, it opens up a whole area of public service delivery, and of course it unlocks huge value in assets that are locked up in land. The surveys that we do suggest that on average an Indian household has 77% of their assets in land and only 7% in financial assets. So you can see how important this is. And of course, of that 77%, as the Secretary, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, reminded me this morning, there's a lot of scam behind those supposed land ownership schemes. And so getting to digital and reliable land records is the foundation for, I would expect, a lot of poverty reduction in our country, because it would unlock value of a tremendous nature. So we're very proud to have done this work. It's a pilot, it's a pioneering work, it's not a pilot anymore. We've done too much effort into this, and the team has worked very hard, but it is something that we hope will grow and evolve, and you will see that work will progress and people will talk about the work that we are planning to do. So with that, let me stop. I didn't introduce myself. I'm Shekhar Shah. I'm the general sort of do nothing buddy here, also the director general. And I'm going to hand over to Shilpa Kumar, who, as I said, is the investment partner at Umidia Network India, responsible for this work. Shilpa, do you want to speak from there? You can use that microphone or come here.
Thank you, Shekhar. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think we're seeing really a pioneering report being released today. But I thought before we get into the actual business of the day, it would be useful to just maybe recap a little bit about Umidyar and what is it, this little sisterhood that Shekhar spoke about. Why did we, in a sense, support it, and how it is shaping up? So I thought maybe I'll just spend a few minutes doing that. So first of all, Umidia Network India, we are an investment firm focused on social impact. We think there's something fairly unique about the way we do our work, which is that we have what we call a dual checkbook, a checkbook out of which we can write checks for both equity investments as well as a checkbook for doing grants, where we think that will be more impactful. We are funded entirely by the philanthropic capital of Pam and Pierre Omidyar, who's the founder of eBay. If one line was to describe us, it is this. We invest in bold entrepreneurs who help create a meaningful life for every Indian. That's really what, you know, entirely Omidyar Network is about. And bold entrepreneurs, as you will see, can be both for-profit, not-for-profit, could even be, to our minds, research scientists who collaborate in this effort. Since 2008, we've invested almost $300 million in India. We have around 100 active investments. To our mind, we've reached about 500 million people in terms of reach, not directly because we don't do anything directly, but through the work of our grantees. We think we will invest another 350 million over the next 5 years. But all of this investment, we believe, will be in service of the next 500 million. And when you say next 500 million, to our minds, it is those 500 million people who we expect are going to come online for the first time by 2022 via their mobile phones. We think this opens up a humongous opportunity for India, because all of a sudden, data access, mobile phones, and technology can really come in play to solve very many problems. So just a quick sense of whom we mean by next 500 million. You know, if you look at the numbers, really the rich, the middle income is what we call the first 500 million. We feel the Indian entrepreneurial spirit has ensured there's very many problem solvers out there, you know, developing solutions for this first 500 million. So we want that our 300 million goes really in service of the next 500 million. People who are going to come online for the first time, people whose, you know, average salary or income is around 20,000 rupees a month, people who are really aspiring to be part of the new India. And therefore, you know, our dual checkbook comes really handy. The first thing we do with it is we actually support for-profit entrepreneurs. The interesting thing is there are enough entrepreneurs who, even for this next 500 million, are happy to actually put up a business case, make a business model, and make it work. So we support them. I mean, just for illustration, you know, Pratilipi. It's a local language publishing platform doing remarkably well in vernacular languages. We also spend our money, second part of what we do is institutional and market infrastructure. Like I said, it can be a report. So for example, Credit Disrupted was a report about SMEs and how they were accessing credit. Or it could be a data platform. So eGov is one of our early investments. We've been with them now for almost 4 or 5 years. It's a technology platform that really helps municipalities and urban local bodies to manage everything with technology. And, you know, states which have adopted it have seen a fairly good improvement in property tax collection, service to citizens, etc. The third thing we do is policy and regulatory support. Again, it can be partly, you know, capacity building, or partly it can be in terms of evidencing of data. Our overall approach, what we call, you know, focus on good tech. And good tech, we think of it in two pillars. The first is actually using technology for good access to aspirational services, employment, productivity. So the whole thing about, you know, tech going out and helping improve people's lives directly. But I think somewhere we are also very focused on being responsible about the use of tech, because you know, I'm sure all of you realize that very easily good tech can flip into something else because there's a lot of concentration of data, which also means the ability, you know, for technology and data to be used against individual agency. So we want to kind of balance, you know, tech for good with responsible tech you know, focus our efforts on both these areas. Having said that, there is also room to ensure that there are non-tech solutions which are also required And where, you know, applicable, we would also invest in that. Busy slide, but that's really reflective of our work. We work in 6 different areas, digital identity, education, emerging technology, financial inclusion, governance, citizen engagement, and property rights. I'm not going to go into depth over here, but suffice to say it's a mixture of for-profit entrepreneurs, research, social entrepreneurs, and sometimes government work. Property rights is where I want to focus 2 minutes of your time. Property rights, we do believe, is the cornerstone for economic development and poverty reduction. Why we think this is in these 3 numbers: 77% of a household's assets are in land and housing. 66% of civil cases are related to this asset, which is so important in people's lives. And 23% of households actually feel worried that they could lose their land or their homes against their will. And therefore, at Omidyar, led by Shreya, the thought process which we really crafted was in these 4 streams. The first was really mainstream the property rights narrative. How do we build data? How do we build evidence of problems? How do we attract new problem solvers? We felt that, if 77% of household assets is land and property, I mean, surely it deserves a lot more research attention than it was getting just now. The second thing, we looked at was supporting state capacity. This could be in terms of, social entrepreneur like FES, or it could be a technology player like Transurf, and I'll talk about that in a minute. The third was really to promote tech-enabled platforms to reduce the cost of citizens accessing their property records. And lastly was to actually help with money for people to unlock the value of their assets, even if sometimes informal. Something like, say, a slum dweller who has home, he doesn't have formal rights, but he still wants maybe funding. And we've done that through our support of, mortgage funding of these informal assets through Sitara, as well as another entity called Seva Rerin. If I, look at now our work with governments, one thing you'll see is sometimes it is working with ministries centrally. Sometimes it is actually working, our investees working in partnership with state governments and maybe even gram panchayats. So for example, FES, and I just want to call them out, they've actually been working with gram panchayats to preserve commons. So the use of NREGA funds to develop and maintain commons and to really, with the help of gram panchayats, develop mechanisms for doing that. Something else we've done, which we are particularly excited about, is our work with Tata Trust in Orissa, where government of Orissa wanted to give title to slum dwellers. We enabled, with the use of drones, for this to be done at much cheaper costs, much faster, and in a sense, set a role model for others who wanted to use the same. Transurf, again, want to call them out simply because they use, drones and geospatial technology to really help improving, property tax payments and collection. So if you get a sense of, the kind of work we are investing in, it's really a very wide-ranging set of things. I want to conclude by talking a little bit about the sisterhood that Shekhar mentioned. I must say we are very pleased over the last year and more that we have had NCAER and NIP, Brookings and CPR come together to actually, build, I would say, a body of work focusing on property and very many aspects of it. You'll get a glimpse of that in the gallery, something really nice that has been done. Thank you to all of you for that. So you can see it's a very wide-ranging set of building blocks, the way we think about it, which can help inform action in the future. The very last thing I want to spend a minute on is, besides, you know, research of this kind, we've done a couple of other small things, which is we've actually had a research innovation grant to look for fresh research, you know, for people to kind of come out with new research ideas, which we will support. And also done an investment through NCOR to actually come out with entrepreneurs, whether social or for-profit, who have ideas they want to, you know, scale up in this space. And we had a prize for that as well. So, you know, with that, I must say I'm looking forward to the release of this very pioneering work. And I would say it would really inform a lot of things going forward in terms of how states are looking at this subject. Thank you.
I would now like to call our project lead, Mr. Deepak Sanand, who is a retired IS officer and a senior advisor at NCR.
Thank you. Thank you, friends. As Shekhar mentioned, we have a set of shrinking violets leading this work. Professor D.V. Gupta, Somnath Sen, and myself. I just happen to be the least successful in shrinking, so I have to be upfront and speak to you. I'll just spend, I hope, no more than my allotted 5 minutes on addressing just five things. I want to start by saying, where did this come from? This came from, and I'm really very glad that we have with us KP today, KP Krishnan, who really started this journey in a sense, because when he was additional secretary at DOLR, it was he who thought that, yes, it is about time that more than 25 years of work on computerization of land records through central programs, some kind of impact assessment is in order. It was that which led to the first three-state pilot assessment, which ON funded and which we participated in with IGIDR and NIPFP, and which led to this very interesting idea of developing an index for all states and union territories of India. It was that initial thrust which revealed the possibilities which we capitalized on in making this index. What were the most sort of challenging aspects of doing this? There were the standard issues of, you know, how to sample, getting the right data, the asymmetries of information, the access, which the doors which do open often to retired IAS officers, but often don't, even to retired IAS officers. And that is always a challenge in India, getting information. The failure of people to respond when you're seeking what should be publicly available. So all that apart, we went through all that and we surmounted most of these challenges. What gave the most satisfaction at the end? I think the most satisfaction came from the fact that here's this area of land, unglamorous, something which in the states, especially below the secretary level, IAS officers, barring a few states, will not really like to hold as a job. And people are often thrust into them. And despite that, this process of the last few months was an uncovering of unsung heroes, I would say. People who are in the states doing phenomenal work, who are in a quiet, dedicated way, pushing forward the agenda of digitizing land records, of doing better on registration, improving the quality in states as far apart as, you know, Manipur at one end or West Bengal to Goa. It was, for me, a great learning to see that, yes, people will do their jobs. Some people will always find an interest and satisfaction in doing their jobs. And that's really was very, very good to see. What surprised? The surprise was the fact that the index shows there is a lot of variation between doing well on this index and what we regard as well-governed states very often. And that may have been a surprise for many, but it's linked to what I said earlier, that this is an area where there are unsung heroes who are going about their business. And the lesson which comes out is that what is really holding back progress is a lot of inertia more than anything else. There is less of antagonism, of visible, specific, you know, aggressive sort of resistance to change. I would suspect that a lot of it is just inertia. You can, I mean, putting your record, digitized record on the web, but not making it available in a legally usable form to people, I think is not something which is happening by and large because there's a lot of antagonism. People are not just going forward to the next step very often. And this came out in area after area of the 14 areas we looked at as part of making up this index. So at the end, I would just say that, so it's been a journey which shows immense possibilities, and it also enabled us to actually lay out a roadmap for state after state, that if you want to improve on this kind of index, there are a lot of steps which are short-term and which can be taken quickly. There are longer-term steps which will take you a little more time, but they're all possible. There is no such thing and not being let, allowing them to happen. And I hope those will get picked up. And when we reassemble, I hope in a year's time, we'll have an index which shows much more progress, which also adds value with a survey of citizen views, client views of how good is digitization, how useful is it, how aware are people of this. All that I hope we will be able to capture in a year. And I hope, sincerely hope, that we'll come back and assemble to an index which shows a lot of changes occurred in the 1 year because the unsung heroes picked up a lot of what we were saying and took it forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Deepa.
I think we'll move on, and we are very privileged to have Tarun Kapoor, who's Vice Chairman of DDA, with us.
Thank you and good afternoon. Digitization of land records is something very important. I would just talk a little bit about Delhi, because Delhi is a totally strange kind of a system which is one experiences here. After coming back from the state where land records are maintained in a particular fashion, in Delhi it was quite a shock, because here we have some areas which are still rural. So in rural areas, land records are maintained in the normal fashion. There's this, the revenue agencies, they maintain land records. And as soon as the area becomes urban, the those agencies, suddenly they vanish. And there seems to be no one
responsible for maintaining the land records.
So while we have the layouts, we have a hierarchy of plans which DDA looks after. So we have the master plan, then we have the zonal plans, and then we have the layout plans. So layout plans are supposed to give details about the plots and the other details in all the urban areas. So layout plans have been prepared for most of Delhi. I would say about 70% of Delhi is covered with layout plans. And actually, layout plan in a city is what truly reflects how the land is distributed. This layout then has to be superimposed on the khasra plans of the revenue department, which has not really happened in Delhi. So therefore, sometimes there's a bit of a mismatch. And then the layouts prepared by DDA may sometimes not actually match with the actual ground situation. So we have the land use, actual land use. So those actual land use maps have not been prepared for Delhi. So we are in the process of doing that now. We've got these agencies which are going to do it using drone surveys. And we'll get these maps prepared. Layout digitization is currently on, which DDA is doing. So we have one agency which is doing it. And so very soon, in say a few months, at least this part would be made available to the public, so anyone can then at least go to that particular site and get an idea about the area. But then relating that to the original revenue maps, the khasras, is again going to remain a challenge. So we are in the process of getting a system in place where the layouts, the khasra maps, and the actual land use on site, they would be available, and then it will be constantly updated, so that all this information is made available to the public. But as of now, it's not. And then, as far as maintaining of land records is also is concerned, so in normally in other areas, at least in Himachal, that's what I know about. So the revenue agencies continue to maintain land records even in urban areas, and we have a system where after a land transaction takes place, the property is registered, and there is a mutation, and mutation is in the revenue records. But here also the term mutation is used, but it's not in the revenue records, because revenue records are not maintained. So mutation, when we use here, it's just an entry which reflects the status of that particular property in the municipal records for the purpose of payment of taxes. So it's not actually reflecting the ownership even legally or even otherwise. So that's the kind of system which is in place. So DDA does mutation for certain areas which are still with DDAs. So in Delhi we have the system that the newer areas first are looked after by DDA. After the area is developed, then it's handed over to the urban bodies. So so for certain areas we are also doing mutations, and we are maintaining these records. And most of the areas, the records are maintained by the urban bodies, but they are not, strictly speaking, revenue records. They are for tax purposes. So therefore, Delhi, I would say, as of now, doesn't even have a proper system for maintenance of land records. I'm not sure what is the situation in the other larger cities in the country, but there is a need for some system to look after the urban areas and to have some kind of urban areas, because the urban area land parcels are plotted in a different manner, and as I mentioned, that the most basic and the best document which reflects how the plots are located are the layouts. And for that, the planning agency is responsible. So this is just in nutshell what the situation is in Delhi. But then any work on this and any discussion on this is most welcome, because there's lots to learn. And if a proper system comes up, then it has to evolve through a lot of discussion and a lot of research, because a lot of understanding is required on this subject. And so important, this figure, I've earlier also been quite surprised that such a large percentage of the court cases are land. And DDA, I have 26,000 court cases. So, and at any point in time, I have about 200 contempts against me all the time. So one can imagine. I have a panel of 600 lawyers. So that's the kind of 600. So that's the kind of work we generate for the courts. So, thank you.
Thank you, Tarun. And let me reassure you that there will be no contempt that you will be held to. And indeed, the fact that you make the time to come, I think, opens up a whole area of work. Plus, you are our neighbor, so that's even better. And then you belong to the same service as Deepak does or did. So that even... Oh, was he your boss? Ah, that... See, these... wheels under in within wheels. But thank you so much, Tarun, for coming. And I think we want to release the report now, and then I'm very keen to hear Ramesh. So
I would also like to call Mr. Somnath Sen and Professor D.B. Gupta on the stage for the release of the report, please.
So just so that people know, there are three different pieces of work. There's the main report, then there is a state compendium, and I'm very glad to see the gentleman from Sikkim who's here, and of course there is also a short overview for those of you who have a shorter attention span. So we've catered for all here. So I think we should recognize the team now. Can the team please stand, and can we give them a big hand, please? Charu, Anika, Prerna, all our intern friends. Yeah, they're all kind of popping up. Please come. We need a photograph with all of you. This is really hard work. I have to tell you that I have never seen people doing so many mouse clicks as these people have, because we first wanted to dirty our hands doing it the mechanical way. I can assure you that not a single byte of data has been scraped. So, let's give them a big hand, please. And may I call now on Ramesh Abhishek to give his keynote remarks. Ramesh.
Let me first compliment NCER, Deepak, and the entire team for doing this absolutely outstanding work. I have literally spent thousands of hours in my term in DIPP, DPIIT, trying to work on improving ease of doing business, both on the side of World Bank Doing Business report, as well as the competition among states, ranking of states on ease of doing business. And also we did a lot of work on ranking of states on startups, how much support they are giving to startups. And while there have been some remarkable achievements, two areas were the most challenging, as you know: registration of property and enforcement of contracts. And sometimes, you know, you wonder as to why we achieved quite a bit in many areas, but why the progress is so dismal in these two. So a very short analysis, if you do, wherever it needed some process re-engineering, use of technology, some amendment of changes of rules, etc., convergence of services, and follow up with the stakeholders, we made some remarkable progress. But areas like registration of property, they need very persistent hard work over a long period of time. Now, I literally spent lot of hours, if not thousand, definitely a couple of hundred, on registration of property, trying to understand and work on this issue in Delhi and Mumbai, explaining to the World Bank team what we have done, and also getting feedback from stakeholders about what they thought of those reforms. The dramatic conclusions which have been arrived at, the picture that has been presented in this report and the index is very much what we heard from the stakeholders. It is also what the World Bank found also from the respondents, and that's why our ranking is where it is. So the question is why it is not getting done. And come to think of it, the districts were set up in India primarily for administration of the land revenues, collection of land revenues, and the deputy the collectors and deputy commissioners had their primary role for that. So we definitely had good land records once upon a time, but why it has become so messed up that today, when we are able to achieve so much in so many areas, the record is so mixed here. First of all, I think we need to have a strong political ownership so that you have people who achieve, good officers are posted for a tenure and given full responsibility and resources to do whatever it takes to get the land records and everything else in shape, so that there is the title of land records or property is not into such huge, massive question, which is disturbing everybody, investors and bankers and buyers. Everyone has a problem with the authenticity of the land titles or property titles. I think this Bhumi project in Karnataka, Krishnan knows, basically it was championed by somebody. And he worked hard, and I'm sure the state government supported him over a period of time. So definitely that political ownership is important. I would suggest that, you know, taking advantage of the data and findings of this survey, and the next logical conclusion may be to look at a very robust ranking framework of states. Because unless and until that kind of thing happens, there's no pressure to perform on the state governments. And somehow it has not come to the priority of the states so far. So piecemeal efforts are made here and there, some excellent work is done here and there, but you have to take it to the logical conclusion, because this is not an area where you can 30% or 40% progress means anything at all, actually. So in Mumbai, virtually all the property cards are digitized, and the registrar offices records are also digitized for almost 30 years now, but the access for the people is very poor. It's very difficult to get access to many of these records. And in any case, the authenticity, etc., no one is sure about the titling part. And Bombay, I think, is one of the better performing places, in at least in maintenance of urban records. So we definitely need a pressure on the states to perform through a ranking framework. I found that in ease of doing business and startups, having a set of good practices by various states and stakeholders was a great motivator. Basically, a lot of good work is done. People need to understand, share, and learn from each other. We also had this mentorings and mentee states in both these programs, so that the well-performing states actually mentored those who were less well-performing. I think that kind of thing also really helps. And many of these things, actually, they set out a competition. But then this entire effort, it has to be promoted and coordinated by the central government. Department of Land Records is definitely ideally placed to do that. But it has to be a very collaborative exercise. Any ranking exercise I have seen, which is only aimed at naming and shaming, does not achieve any purpose. It has a very limited purpose. And you need to combine this with sharing of good practices, capacity development, incentivizing people. From the department, we even sent two officers of every state, the Secretary of Industries and the Mission Leader of Startups, on a one-week trip to either to Silicon Valley, US, or to Israel, just to understand and see what startup ecosystem should look like, to incentivize them, to inspire them. And I can tell you, many of them came back extremely inspired, and they worked even harder, and they achieved many more after they came back. So I think that is very important, to inspire them. And then I think centrally there has to be, I have seen in the report, you also need to have some centrally accepted uniform terminologies, so that if you want to maintain a national database, you can access those records seamlessly. There are too many differences across states. I think this is definitely a very important effort. And also technology, also applications can be made available centrally. This might be already being done, I don't know, Krishnan will know better. But definitely that really helps. And if some states have some software or application or a good database, that format can be shared with other states as well. So that otherwise, whenever you go to a particular state, it normally they are very hesitant to procure technology, applications, training is a problem. So these things have to be provided centrally. There has to be a team. We put a team of two or three people with every state. And those people have to stay there for a few months and work hard. Otherwise, locally, people are very reluctant to deploy resources, or maybe the resources are also not of that expected quality, having expertise. So this is a very massive effort that needs to go into it, because having this index is fantastic. Extremely, it's a reality check on a very important program that was implemented by the central government for last many, many decades. But more important, perhaps, would be how to take it forward, make it successful in the sense that we finally get to have a land record system where all the titles can be known, can be authenticated. Even if you don't have conclusive titling system, there should be a reasonable assurance that there will be people can actually trust whatever records they see. And the databases talk to each other, whether they are cadastral maps or registrar records or land records or in property cards or whatever. I think all these things are can be done. We have done much more, but since it needs persistent effort, it's a painstaking work. I have seen that if you have a meeting once in a week or maybe every day or once in a week for 2 years, 3 years, then you see progress. It doesn't happen from dramatic meetings, dramatic events, and you know, make big slogans. It doesn't happen like that. All these are very hard work. People, the team that has done this work, they, I'm sure, they have seen the amount of work that is required to be done by people who need to reform. So we have all the good examples. We have best practices. We need a strong political determination, and we need to incentivize each other and create a movement in the country that we must set it right. This is important for so many reasons, whether it's enforcement of law, criminal law. So many land disputes are creating so many problems. It is choking civil courts. You have seen the data that the percentage of such litigations in civil courts are extremely high. So if you see, it has cascading effect on our society, on our economy. Big investors don't have much problem. They find out with use of legal resources as to what needs to be done. But the amount of effort they have to take, the amount of effort lenders, banks, NBFCs have to take to assure them of the authenticity of the title, I don't think is helping anyone. So once again, congratulations. Fantastic work done by the team. And I'm sure that the next logical steps will be taken. And special compliments to Krishnan. During his stewardship, this project was sanctioned. And this has been taken to its conclusion by Deepak and his wonderful team. My best wishes to you for the future as well. Thank you.
I think we should just move on to the actual discussion of the report. And I'll request my fellow panelists here to take seats in the audience. And then we will listen to this presentation on the report itself. And I guess it's Prerna and Charu. You're going to come, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. So against this rich background that has already been discussed, so I'll straight go to the findings of the NCER Land Records and Services Index 2020. What are we trying to achieve through NCER Land Records and Services Index? So the aim is to gauge three broad things. First is the extent of digitization of land records. So when I say land records, it's textual records, spatial records, and the registration process. And the ease of access of the land record that has been brought about by this digitization. And third is the improvement in the quality of land records that the digitization brings. So again, there's three broad questions. This is how the NLRSI looks like. This is the composition and the structure of the index. Broadly, we have four components. So the first three relates to the extent of digitization of land records. So we have textual records, spatial records, and registration with 20 points each. The last and the fourth is the quality of land records with 40 points. And within the textual records, spatial records, registration, and the quality of land records, we have further subcomponents with different scores, as is indicated on the screen. And the way we have evaluated all these parameters was a mix of many methods, which included desk research, test checks. So when I say test checks, it means we did sample test checks based on the sample that we selected. Information that we obtained from the state-specific knowledge correspondence. So these were the three sources through which we obtained the information and went about computing this index. And I'll straight go to the rankings, the final rankings for NLRSI 2020. Out of 37 Indian states and UTs, we have this ranking for 33 states. The rest are the four states, which includes Nagaland, Mizoram, Meghalaya, and Arunachal Pradesh. They are not on this index because they do not have their written land records available, or the land records are not in a standardized format to be digitized. So on the index, the first state is Madhya Pradesh, followed by Odisha, Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, and Tamil Nadu. And these are the scores with an average of 38.5. So against the second slide that I had shown on the NLRSI composition, so I'll just go component wise. So the first is the textual record, which is the record of rights. So the first attempt when analyzing the textual record digitization was to compare what the states report on the Department of Land Resources website or what the states have reported through their state sources with what we have achieved from our sample test checks. So this is a figure showing the comparison between the reported extent of digitization by the states on DOLR or from state sources with our test checks. So as we can see, barring few states, there's not much variation between what has been reported in terms of the textual record digitization and what we see from the checks that we did by actually accessing the state-specific land portals. As I had said that textual record digitization has two components. The first is the extent of ROR digitization with 15 points. And this is totally based on the sample test checks that the team has done by accessing the state-specific land portals and checking for the digitization for particular villages that were selected as a part of the sample. So these are the scores out of total of 15 points. And yeah, again, I would like to mention that this check could be done only for the states that have their web portals available. And states like Sikkim that have digitized land records but have not put the land records on web, this check could not be conducted. So this check was done for 28 states and UTs in India. Now, the second component for the textual record digitization is the availability of legally usable copies. So to have the records digitized is one thing, but then whether the records are legally usable is assessed based on this parameter. And this parameter has 5 points out of 20 for textual record digitization. So 15 is for the extent of digitization and 5 points are for the availability of a legally usable copy. And again, the way we have allotted points to the states is the following. The states where a digitally signed copy is available from web, so those states get 5 points, 5 out of 5. States where one has to visit the citizen service center to get a signed copy, those states get half the total points, that is 2.5. And states where one has to go to the office or the relevant revenue department to get the copy of the ROR, they do not get any point on this component. So when we add these two subcomponents, this is how the textual record digitization score looks like. So again, so in terms of the structure, so this gives us the full score for the first component, which is the textual record. So the 20 points of the textual record are highlighted here, and this is how the states perform on the first component of NLRSI. The second component, as I had mentioned, is the spatial record digitization. So again, we follow the same procedure wherein first we begin by comparing what states have reported on DOLR or what do they report through state sources with what we have obtained from the checks that we have done by accessing the land record portals. And in contrast to what we had seen in the textual record digitization, there's a huge variation in what DOLR reports or what states report on DOLR and what we actually saw from the checks that we have done. So if we compare textual records and spatial records, we can say that states are performing better in terms of textual records as compared to the spatial records, which are the cadastral maps. And yeah, again, as was discussed in the case of textual records, only 28 states were considered because it was conditioned on the fact for how many states a web portal is available. Similarly, in this case, this check could be conducted for 14 states that have a portal available, a portal which is accessible. Yeah, so based on the percentage that we have obtained from the sample checks, the success percentage, so this is how the states have performed in terms of the first component of spatial record digitization, which is the extent of CM digitization. So these are the scores for the 14 states, and this is out of 15. And similarly, as we have done for the textual records, again, we have given points to the states for availability of a legally usable copy of a cadastral map, which is a spatial record. And the points are again given based on these three broad categories, whether a copy is available in a digitally signed format, then a state would get full marks, that is 5 points. If one has to go to the Citizen Service Center, then 2.5 and 0 points for a state where for the states where you still have to go to the relevant department to get the copy of a cadastral map. So adding these two components, this is the final score for the extent of cadastral map digitization, which again I'll take you to the structure slide, which is the second component of NLRSI with 20 points. So these are the next 20 points for the states that have their web portals available for the spatial records. So with respect to the structure slide, this is the third component for NLRSI, which is the registration. So here we are talking about digitization of registration, and the way we have went about doing this check or assessment is that we have divided the entire registration process into 5 stages, starting with online data entry, where we are saying that a state should have a web portal to allow citizens to fill in the required details that are important for starting a registration. The second is the online availability of a circle rate, which is minimum price of a land, and we propose that the updated circle rates should be put up on web and should be available online. Then third is the mode of payment, stamp duty payment. So there can be 2 provisions. One is the availability of e-stamps, or probably a citizen can actually make a payment online. So we say that e-stamps are, so online payment is better than e-stamps. So on our index, a state where the provision for online payment is available, so that state gets full 4 marks, and where there's a provision for an e-stamp, that state would get 2 marks. So the third component is like for four marks. So each of the components is for 4 points each, making 20, total of 20 for the registration process. Now the fourth is a provision for online attestation of the registered document. So online attestation by the sub-registrar officer. And the last is the provision of the final registered document online. So, and these are, and as per our checks and assessment, these are the number of states that have these provisions in place. And I'll just briefly talk about how did we go about doing these assessments. So the first one, which is about the online data entry, and the third one, which is the mode of payment, stamp duty payment. These two are based on our desk research for the web portals, possible web portals that are available for these two purposes. The fourth and fifth stages, that is the provision for attestation of registered document and online delivery of registered document. These two are based on the information that we obtained from the knowledge correspondence. And the second component, which is online availability of circle rate, was based on the sample checks that we did for the same villages that were selected for the textual record digitization. So as I mentioned, this was the only component for which sample test checks were conducted. And this is how the states have performed. So this subcomponent is of 4 points. And this is the percentage, the success percentage in our checks. So a state like Sikkim, where the land records are the textual land records, that is the RORs, are digitized but not put up on web, but they do quite well in terms of their registration, the circle rates availability online. So combining all these five stages of registration that I've mentioned, this is the placement of states on the component of registration. Again, taking back to the structure slide, this is the third component with 20 points. So these three completes the first part of the index, which is the extent of digitization of land records. The fourth component with 40 points is the quality of land records. The first subcomponent of quality of land records is the real-time updating of ownership. So this is totally based on the information that we have achieved from the state-specific knowledge correspondence. And the way we have tried to give points to the states is in the following way. Again, I'll just like to mention that, so while talking about real-time updating of ownership, what we are trying to see is how better the registration department and the revenue departments are linked. So, we are going through the different degrees of linkages between revenue department and the registration department. So states where the sub-registrar offices can only view the ROR, the textual records online, before starting a registration. There are five states, and this category gets 2.5 points. And states where SROs can send an SMS to the revenue office on an instance of a registration is the second category. And the third category is states where an automatic note is generated on an instance of a registration. So a note is generated in the record of rights, which is the textual record. So, and the fourth category, which is an ideal category, states with instant mutation with 5 points, but unfortunately there's no state with such a provision. So the maximum a state gets on this component is an automatic note, which is generated in the ROR. So the maximum a state gets on this index, on this subcomponent, is 3.75. So this was the first component, which is derived totally for the from the information that we have obtained from the state sources. The second subcomponent for the quality of land records is the extent of joint ownership. So this is the picture of how states perform in terms of the extent of joint ownership. So obviously, a good record, a good quality record, should have the least, extent of joint ownership, and the more the number of the degree of joint ownership, it is better for the, it is obviously poor for the quality of land records, as it would increase the chances for the litigation, or it would hamper the transaction intensity in a state. So here I would just specifically mention the cases like of Uttarakhand, where there was an instance of of a plot having a joint ownership of around more than 200 owners. So obviously that state would get a penalty. So the higher the joint ownership, the more would be the penalty, and poorer would be the performance on this subcomponent of quality of land records. So the third component under the quality of land records is land use congruence, where we have tried to compare the land use that is given in the textual record, and we have tried to see that particular plot on the Google Earth imagery, and we have tried to just compare whether the land use which is given in the textual record, the ROR, actually how does it compare to what we see in the Google Earth imagery. So I would like to mention that there are 14 states that I had mentioned earlier that have web portals available for the cadastral maps. But out of those 14 states, this check could be performed only for 10 states, because for such a check, we needed a state where village mosaics are available in the cadastral maps. So out of those 14 states, there were only 10 states for which we could get a village mosaic so that this check could be performed. And as we can see, Jharkhand has the maximum congruence in terms of what is there in the record and what we could see from the Google Earth images that we checked. The fourth component here is the land area congruence. So in this component, we try to compare the land area that is given by the record of rights and the land area which is given by the cadastral map. So record of rights are generally considered as the legacy records, and the recent surveys are generally reflected in the cadastral map. So in a way, this exercise helped us see how does a legacy record compare with respect to the cadastral map, which is considered to be quite updated. Again, out of 14 states for which the web portals are available for cadastral maps, this could be performed only for 9 states, because for this particular component, what we needed was that the map should be vectorized for us to calculate the land area. So that's why out of 14 states, this check could be done for 9 states and UTs. And a variation less than 5% did not get any penalty. So, and variation that was more than 5% in different ranges had different penalties. So the last component of the quality of land records is encumbrances. And when we talk about encumbrances, which are the restrictions or conditions that are mentioned in the textual record, the record of rights. So there are 5 categories of encumbrances that we have considered: mortgages, land acquisition proceedings, institution of revenue court cases, institution of civil court cases, and land use restrictions. For this particular component, we relied on the information that we received from the knowledge correspondents from the states. Each of these categories of encumbrances, if it is recorded in a state, so each of these categories got 1 point each. So what we observed was that there was no state that recorded all 5 or even all 4 categories of encumbrances. And the maximum a state records is 3 categories of these 5 categories of encumbrances. So the composite of all these 5 parameters of quality of land records gives us the final score, which is a score out of total of 40 points, and Jharkhand tops the table for the quality of land records, followed by Odisha and Rajasthan. This was about the entire NLRSI 2020 and its component wise assessment. Now, other than the checks and the assessment that we have carried out, we've also tried to briefly summarize the difficulties that we faced while doing these checks. So for example, a state, generally when we access a web portal, there would be some basic administrative units that were needed to be entered. For example, district, followed by tehsil, village, and the plot number. But then there were some states like Maharashtra where you were supposed to enter details like your mobile number or additional details. So we have tried to list states according to states where only the basic details were needed, and the states where more than the basic details were needed to access the land records. Then another access issue related to the CAPTCHA requirement. So we have tried to divide states in terms of how many states, the web portals of the states require us to enter CAPTCHA for accessing the land records. So these are some of the categories of accessibility that we tried to gauge, other than doing the checks that we have done for creating an NLRSI. Now I'll just request Charu to talk about the sampling methodology that was adopted to do the sample test checks that I've mentioned for textual records or spatial records, or even under registration, the circle rates.
Thanks, Priyana. Good afternoon, everybody. I will be talking about the sampling methodology that has been adopted for testing various parameters of the LRSI index. And just would like to start by recalling one of these slides that Prerna has already discussed. So the slide basically gives the LRSI composition covering about 14 parameters which have been classified in four broad dimensions of the textual records, spatial records, registration and quality of land records. So out of these 14 parameters, for basically drawing a sample, the question was that out of these 14 parameters, we need a national representative sample. So based on the preliminary research, it was identified that for under the textual record, for testing the extent of record of rights, for cadastral maps, for circle rates, and some of the parameters under the quality of land records, we can actually conduct the test checks through online mechanisms. And therefore, a statistically representative sample was derived. And for this, two approaches were adopted broadly because the parameters such as the RORs, cadastral maps, or circle rates, the procedure for testing was almost similar. And for other parameters falling under the category of quality of land records, the procedure was different. So two approaches were broadly adopted for sampling. So under the first sampling strategy, we have drawn this sample for testing the extent of digitization of land records and the registration process. So to start with this strategy, firstly, all the states and districts within these states and UTs, they were identified, where the land records, they are digitized as per the DOLR website. So all the districts were covered under these sample states where the records were digitized. After this, three-stage stratified random sampling approach was adopted, where in the first stage, tehsils were selected from these districts, and then at the second stage, village were selected, and third stage, plots or khasra numbers were selected. So for selecting the tehsils, all the tehsils within these digitized districts, they were distributed in two stratums. The first stratum where the cadastral maps were digitized, as per the DOLR website, with a presumption that the RORs also digitized for these tehsils. And second stratum where RORs were only digitized but not the cadastral maps. And together from these two stratums, using PPS approach, which is probability proportional to size, using this approach, five tehsils were selected together from these two stratums. Out of these tehsils, the sample tehsils, 12 villages were selected using circular systematic random approach, and these villages were also used for testing the circle rates as mentioned by Prerna. So registration process basically is the second forms the second part of our strategy, but under the five identified stages of registration process, only circle rates were tested using a sample. So these villages were used for testing the circle rates. From these 12 villages, from each of the village, again using a systematic random sampling approach, one khasra or plot number was selected. We have selected one plot and one khasra number from each village because a dipstick test was adopted for testing the extent of digitization. So this forms the first strategy for testing the extent of digitization of land records and registration process. These are the samples for the record of rights, cadastral maps and circle rates. As already stated, 28 states have been tested for the extent of record of rights, 14 for cadastral maps and 23 for circle rates. So overall, we have tested nearly 32,000 villages, more than 32,000 villages for record of rights, 14,000 villages for cadastral maps and nearly 31,000 villages for the circle rates. The second sampling strategy, this basically was adopted for the quality of land records. So here actually, same sample tehsils were considered, which have already been taken under the sampling strategy 1. And from these sample tehsils, one of the headquarter villages were identified. So this was identified with a presumption that these villages, they reflect most of the changes in the land transfers and land use. So Google Pro softwares were used to identify the identification of these headquarter villages. And from each of the headquarter villages, again using a systematic random sampling approach, five plots were selected. So then using these five plots for each of the villages, three indicators under these quality of land records were tested, which are extent of joint ownership, land use, and land extent. These are the samples for these three components of the quality of land records. For extent of joint ownership, 28 states and UTs were tested, having 13,750 plots, For land use, again 10 states and land area 9 states were covered, because for the requirement of the cadastral maps, where they are available, not only digitized, but they are available in the mosaic form, and also the vectorized line lengths are available for them. So this is all about the sampling procedure. Now I would like to call Prerna to take it forward from here. Thank you.
Thanks, Charu. So this is the final rankings that I have already talked about. So one thing that I would like to mention is that we have also done the sensitivity analysis on our final rankings by considering four different scenarios. And the observation was that the rankings do not change much. In fact, first two to three states remain the same when we have done the sensitivity analysis. And rest for the fourth, fifth state, there's a change of one or one spot. So this was the sensitivity analysis that we have already done. Then next thing that I would like to mention is that we are also planning to launch our portal where all the data of this index, the NLRSI index, would be put up, and this would be put up on our website, NCR's website. So I'll just give a look of the portal. So this is how the portal looks like. So this would have all the four components that I've already discussed. So under textual records, we have digitization of record of rights. So the scores for this particular subcomponent would show up. Similarly, in spatial records and for registration, we have five stages. So you can select any of these stages, and then a state's performance in that particular stage would appear. Additionally, one feature that we have on this portal is changing the ranking criteria that I've just mentioned. So we have done a sensitivity analysis that we can actually do on this portal. So for example, if under quality of land records, I just remove these two subcomponents, updating ownership or recording encumbrances. So how do the states perform on, you know, the changed parameters? So as I had mentioned, the first two states remain the same, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha. And so this is a change. Chhattisgarh moves up from fourth spot to the third spot. So this way, you can select your own parameters under the 14 components, total components of NLRSI, and you can create your own ranking. So if we do not consider one component, so how does the index look like for our state? So yeah, so this was the look of the portal that we are soon going to launch on our website. Thank you. So, maybe in the panel discussion, questions?
Like extent of joint ownership out of 10, say Madhya Pradesh has been given 9.2. So now in this chart, what does it mean?
Means that 9.2 out of 10 marks means that the amount of ownership up to two owners is very high in MP, and the multiple owners are lesser. That's what it means.
Okay. Not the percentage by something.
No, it's
based on that.
It's based on those percentages reduced into numerical numbers. So a very high percentage of up to two owners translates into high marks.
Another part, sir, that okay, this report. Now, what is the state's claim is? I mean, now, okay, this is your report and through the survey. But what is the state's claim? How much do they say that they have achieved? So that, because ultimately it is the state who have to do it.
I think there was a slide you might have missed. There was a slide which showed what the state's claim of achievement on the DOLR website is and what we found. That there was a slide of it. And there is it. It's there. I'll show it to you.
Yeah, this slide.
Thank you, sir. I have just a very small query, because you talked about this encumbrances. Underground utilities passing through a particular plot of land, that is very complicated issue. I have got some personal experience 40 years back. We got a land from DDA, and that was clearly written, land is free from all encumbrances, means litigation or whatever it is. But when we dug out the foundation, there was a cable, telephone cable, having 800 piers. And the worst part is, those authorities were not knowing where the cables are passing. And they refused to accept it. When my laborer and thekedar cut the cable, then everybody woke up. So what I want to say, whether we consider this thing in a particular land record, because as the DDAVC said clearly, urban records in this country are very, very poor, except in few cities. As far as rural are concerned, they are well maintained even from the earlier times. So can you clarify whether we take this or not?
No. The point is, you have answered the question. These encumbrances are not being recorded. The nature of the encumbrance you have mentioned, even the utilities do not even have a proper map of it. So where is it going to get recorded? So it is, we are just highlighting that encumbrances ought to be recorded. We've taken up five common encumbrances which ought to get recorded. These are additional. They must go. Today someone was talking about the fact that in Delhi, whole country today, the whole monument and distance from monument for construction, it's an encumbrance which ought to get recorded. Yes, of course.
Yes.
Nobody is disputing what you are saying. It has to be, it should be recorded, ultimately, yes. Should we pass on to the next session or we'll take one?
You can take
one. Just 1 minute, only 1 minute. Just I want to respond. Abhishek sir mentioned about the Mumbai. Sir, the latest information is that the PRC has been very well integrated with the OBPS system and absolutely there is no need to visit PRC office, sir, CTS office. So this is the latest achievement, but thanks to our secretary, with continuous persuasion with the state government, we are able to integrate with the building plan approval system, and the two more cities have been added, sir. That is a tremendous challenge for us, Bengaluru and Kolkata. And tomorrow, Bengaluru is going to inaugurate common application form. And hopefully the property record also gets integrated. And Bangalore and Kolkata both are working for GIS-based master plans. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for the information. Great. Thank you.